Welcome to Dinosaurs Gone Soft. My name is Eric Hovind. I realize this is a very controversial issue. We've got people on both sides of the equation of what they think about the whole dinosaur soft tissue and what's going on with it. So I'm really excited that you guys are joining us here on this webinar, because I've got some guys that have been studying this for a long time and they really know their stuff when it comes to dinosaur soft tissue. So as we jump in here, I just wanted to say, I realize there's two totally different worldviews. I come from a Christian or a creationist worldview. So I hold that God's word, the Bible, is absolutely true. This is our authority. And the Bible teaches that God made the world about 6,000 years ago. And so I'm going to look at all this dinosaur soft tissue through this lens. Other people say, no, God's word isn't true. The earth is maybe millions of years old or billions of years old. And so they try to fit this dinosaur soft tissue into that worldview. So that's what we're going to be talking about and discussing tonight, is where does it really fit? There's no doubt dinosaurs have gone soft, and you're going to see some phenomenal evidence tonight. Now, what does that mean for you? What conclusions can we draw about this? I am really excited about our guests that are going to be joining me, Dr. Dan Biddle and Brian Thomas. Right before I introduce them and let them talk a little bit about themselves, thank you guys for joining us in this room. Many of you have already found the chat feature. I thought this would be fun because I was in Illinois last weekend and a cold front came through. So if you find the chat feature, it should be on the right-hand side, or if you're on your phone, maybe underneath, you got to toggle back and forth between the chat. If you would find the chat feature, and I want you to tell me what temperature it is outside right now where you're at. What's the temperature where you are at right now? I realize these are going to come flying by really fast, but I'm actually going to pick somebody. I've got a little giveaway that I want to do right here at the beginning. 77, says Brian. Man, that is fantastic. That is really, really nice. 55 from Matt. 51. Oh, it's getting cold out there. 35. I'm sure we're going to have some that are down 30, minus 10 Celsius. Are you serious? That is crazy. All right, so far the minus 10 Celsius is one at 24, 46. All right, here's the deal. The cold, yeah, I'm going to stop. After you guys stop putting it in, I'll tell you what my deal is. I'm going to go back through the chat, and those that responded right during this time before I say what I'm about to say, I'm going to find the coldest one that I see there. And I'm actually going to give away a brand new thing that we just now started. It's actually a flash drive. And this little flash drive contains a huge amount of information on it. I started throwing all of our best resources on this little bitty flash drive. And now I call it the mother load. And our guys here at the office went ahead and put this in as a Black Friday special this week only. You can get over 24 hours of teaching, over $450 worth of resources on 116 flash drive this Black Friday only, and it's going to be gone. It will never come back online as far as I'm concerned, because I only make it available when I travel and speak. So really excited about that. If you want to take advantage of that, you can check that out. But I'm going to look at that coldest one there, and I'm going to let you guys I'm going to pick somebody to send that to. Yes, you should have typed negative 50, Nathan. Liar, then you would have been a liar. You don't want to do that. Let me introduce my guest real quick. Dr. Dan Biddle is from Genesis Apologetics. He's actually out in California. Excuse me, I was about to say Washington. Out in California. Dan, how you doing tonight?
Doing great, Eric. Thanks for having me on.
Praise God that you're here, man. So glad you're here. Tell me real quick, you told me something that happened yesterday, and it was just kind of interesting to me. What happened to you yesterday? Can you tell everybody what happened real quick?
Yes, well, I get out to speak to some Christian colleges in the Northern California area and then some secular colleges too. And yesterday, I was actually out at a local college here, and I gave a version of this to a class of zoologists or pre-med students. It was a class on zoology. And it was real interesting to go over this material, because a lot of people haven't heard about this issue of finding 14 fresh biomaterials in dinosaur bones. It's just incredible. So there was a lot of people who found this topic quite interesting. And of course, we had mixed worldviews in the class and lots of great, interesting questions. But it makes for some good dialogue, because these findings of this fresh biomaterial is just really as new as about 2005 is when it really started getting out there. But it makes for some interesting conversations.
Wow, that is really cool. I'm sure we're going to have some interesting thoughts today on the chat as we talk about this. Let me introduce real quick, though, Brian Thomas. Brian is joining us from the Institute for Creation Research, known as ICR, that is really one of the founders of the creation movement. And I'm really excited to have you on here, Brian. Thanks for joining me. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing great, and I appreciate you having me.
Well, I've been blown away at all the information you know about dinosaurs. I've gotten to sit in on some of your dinosaur talks. Tell us what you do. I know you travel and speak and you write. Can you give everybody kind of a little update on kind of what you do right now at ICR?
Well, for the last 8 years, I've been a science writer, so I put news articles up on our website, icr.org. And for subscribers to our free monthly magazine, Acts and Facts, you'll know that I contribute regularly to that magazine. And in the process, for the first few years of writing these articles, I kept coming across new discoveries of fossils with original, animal materials in them. And so I collected them. I started a collection. I thought, well, someone needs to put all these in one big pile. And so I started the collection and began to realize this is not just one T-Rex from Montana. This is all over the world, and it's throughout the geologic column. So that's one of the neat features that I've been able to observe just by reading the secular technical literature.
So you guys have actually put together kind of a cohesive PowerPoint that takes people through all 14 of these different, these are different different material that have been discovered?
Well, by biomaterials, I'll let Dr. Biddle explain what he means by that. He chose that word, but it's things like proteins and DNA and even whole tissues, and that's what we'll be talking about. Yeah.
Yes. You know, there was an article that just came out this month about some fresh keratin that was found in a dinosaur that secularists date to about 75 million years old. And the term that they chose, which I like, is original organics. So they came out in that article and says, well, we've now confirmed that the keratin that we're finding in this dinosaur claw sheath is an original organic. So yeah, pick your term, fresh biomaterials or original organics. That's what we're looking at here. And it's pretty interesting that these things really shouldn't be in the soil of the earth for millions of years.
Hey, Brian, Jacqueline in the chat just said, I just read Brian's book, Dinosaurs and the Bible. So very cool, Jacqueline. Glad you got to check that out. We got a little bit of a late start, so I want to jump right in. Oh, he's got it right there.
It looks like this
for them to see it.
Yeah, good.
So Brian's actually got that book. He was holding it up. He said, "Man, I've got it right here." That is a great little read. You really ought to check it out. Now, by the way, anybody who stays for this whole presentation, Dan is going to talk a little bit. Brian's going to talk a little bit. Then Dan has an amazing giveaway that he's going to do. And Brian has an amazing thing that he's going to give you. Plus, to top that off, all the PowerPoint slides that you see them using in this presentation, they're giving it away. They're literally going to be giving all this information to you. We're going to have a little link. You only get it if you watch this whole thing. Yes, it's our nice little hook for you. But at the end, I'm going to give this link out, and you're going to be able to click that, hit download, and download every single image that you're going to be seeing as they share this information. It really is going to be cool. All right, so I know some of you guys are going to have questions. I realize that. I'm going to try to collect your questions. I'll copy them and paste them into a document so that as we get a little breaking time, I'll be able to try to pick a couple of those and actually ask some of those questions to Dan and to Brian. So, hey, Dan, you kind of started by sharing this PowerPoint with me, and I said, oh man, we have got to do a webinar with this and let everybody know what's going on. So kick us off here with what we're going to be learning tonight on dinosaurs.
Well, thank you, Eric. I sure will. We're going to be doing a great job if we can get through this in 20 minutes each. So someone be a good timekeeper, and I'll do my best to start to end off about 6:40 and hand the toggles over to Brian for his part. But you guys, should be seeing my screen now. Do you see that all right?
We do. Yes, sir.
I see.
Okay,
it.
Terrific. We will just jump right in. So we've labeled this talk, Dinosaurs Gone Soft. And of course, your two hosts today are myself. I'm the president of Genesis Apologetics. We are a local creation-based ministry out here in Northern California. I've been the author or editor of several different creation books, including our latest one, which is called Debunking Evolution. You can just go to our website, debunkevolution.com, and you can see all of the videos that we have on there. It's really designed for junior high and high school students to go through. We've got some good college material there as well. And then my colleague, Brian Thomas, is going to take us through the second half of this talk tonight. As he mentioned, he's been a science writer for ICR for about 8 years, has a relevant master's degree in this field, and has written several different books on creation-related topics. And last I saw, I think it was hundreds of articles in the creation field. So I'm really happy to partner with Brian for this fun talk. So what we're going to start out with doing tonight is, let's see here if I can get my screen to think about me again. There we go. Okay. Is we're going to be contrasting the secular dinosaur worldview with the biblical creation worldview. And I'm going to really provide this kind of lay out an introductory background for Brian to go into the actual original organics that we've been talking about here. But to set the stage here, we all know that the secular worldview says that dinosaurs started out about 220 million years ago and then went extinct about 65 million years ago. And there are, last we counted, about 200 different theories and ideas of how and why the dinosaurs went extinct, with some prevailing ones nowadays involving asteroids. But the Bible has a much different story about dinosaurs, their origin, how they got started, and how most of them went extinct. And we'll take a look at that view right now. So the first thing is taking this biblical dinosaur step is that we know that dinosaurs existed. We have a little bit over 100,000 fossils that have been collected, representing about 100,000 individual dinosaurs. Interestingly, about 97% of the dinosaur fossil collection consists of disarticulated bones that we believe were mangled up and put into a massive blender called Noah's Flood just over 4,000 years ago. But we know when we look at dinosaurs, we've got the proof. You just dig them up right out of the soil in certain different places. There's lots of bone beds, but it's quite obvious that dinosaurs existed. And their design really demands a designer. When you sit down and look at dinosaurs carefully, like we will in just a moment, you'll see they're really fabulous creatures. So we know that the Bible clearly says that God created all living things, therefore God created dinosaurs. So these dinosaurs were created on day six of creation as land-dwelling, air-breathing creatures, created right before he created man. Then Adam was immediately put in charge to name all the animals and then was given the dominion charge over them. So that's, we would say, clearly puts dinosaurs with man because they were made immediately before man, and then Adam was told to name all the animals. The fifth step is that we know that the Bible does, in at least two different places, mention creatures that we believe are dinosaurs. The first one is Behemoth. That's in Job chapter 40, and following that section is a section on another one called Leviathan. But Behemoth's real interesting. We're going to take a look at Behemoth tonight. The Hebrew of the word Behemoth would actually suggest the phrase colossal beast. So we're dealing with a huge creature here. There are 13 characteristics that are described in Job chapter 40 that would lead us to believe that Behemoth is actually a giant sauropod dinosaur. The sixth step I want you to take with me is that all land-dwelling, air-breathing creatures died in the worldwide flood about 4,400 years ago. And we believe that that included dinosaurs. And part of the reason that this flood happened was that God was bringing judgment to all flesh. And the Bible is very clear that all flesh on earth, both animals and humans, had corrupted their way on earth. So a cataclysmic, catastrophic, worldwide global flood wiped everything out except for the animals that were kept alive on Noah's Ark for about the 1 year long flood process. So moving on and taking a look at a graphic of how this can be represented here, we have a 6,000 year time frame on the bottom. Biblical creationists would hold to a worldview that says that the earth is only about 6,000 years old. We have the dinosaurs being created on the sixth day of creation because they were land-dwelling, air-breathing creatures. And then we have fallen corruption that that Adam and Eve brought into the earth. And we know that when they brought sin into the earth and they rebelled against God, we have the fall and corruption started on earth. So there were several hundred years of corruption that happened that included the animals as well. Then we have the flood extinction event that happened about 2,350 BC, or about 4,300 years ago, that wiped out all the animals except for those that were on board Noah's Ark. We believe that there were probably about 85 different kinds of dinosaurs that were kept alive on Noah's Ark. Sometimes secularists would put that that number to 50. I've seen creationists put it at 85, but somewhere between 50 and 85 interfertile dinosaur kinds are believed to have existed on the planet before the flood. So after the flood, those creatures got out, the 50 to 85 kinds of dinosaurs got off the ark, rapidly scattered around the earth, but then quickly went extinct because they were hunted, they were hungry because the world was not a very friendly place to them, and they weren't really equipped for what we would call the second version of Earth. The first version of Earth was a tropical paradise, probably not a lot of mountains, a lot more, maybe the different barometric pressures were involved, different oxygen layers. There's a lot of speculation we could put into what that world was like, but it was much more of a tropical paradise than what we have today. And we know that from the fossil record. And we also know it from the way that these creatures were designed. And we'll take a look at that as we go through here. So I want to touch briefly on Job chapter 40 and look at that creature that God calls Behemoth. And God has kind of given Job a reality check here. And he says, Job, I want you to consider Behemoth, which I made along with you, like on the sixth day of creation. And this is a creature that's so big, it's got a tail that sways like a cedar tree. It's got bones that are beams of bronze. And then interestingly, that eighth point, God calls it the chief, or the first in rank of all of God's creations. So he's getting Job's attention with the largest, most incredible creature that he made, because he's trying to get Job's attention and say, listen to me, I'm going to tell you this huge creature I made called Behemoth. It's the chief, or the first of all my work, and it's got a tail that sways like a cedar tree. Well, if you look at all living and extinct animals, an Apatosaurus dinosaur, this giant sauropod up here, is really the only creature that would fit all 13 of these characteristics, certainly would be the only one that had a tail that swayed like a cedar tree. So when you go through these 13 descriptions in the book of Job, we see that a sauropod dinosaur nicely fits all 13 characteristics. And things like a hippopotamus, what some Bible scholars have speculated, maybe Behemoth was a giant hippo, or maybe it was a crocodile. We really get a mixed lineup between the characteristics of Behemoth and a hippopotamus and a crocodile. So certainly the creature to fit the description best throughout all of history would be a giant sauropod. And the book of Job, I would add, was written about 3,500 years ago. So next, we'll take a look at some evidence that we believe fits this biblical account, the seven steps that we just went through. The first is that dinosaurs were incredibly designed. Here's a picture of a large sauropod leg. You can just look at the construction of this giant creature, how well fabricated it is, the weight distribution that starts with a huge femur up here and goes down to a couple more bones and several other more. Someone had to design this. This really represents phenomenal engineering, if you will. We've got a hip system up here that starts and displaces the weight to one big, huge bone, breaks it down into two, so there can be some twisting and bending here, to smaller foot bones and then toe bones. It's really an amazing design. Here's even a picture of a Diplodocus toe bone. You can see how large these creatures were. There's even Apatosauruses like Argentinosaurus and Titanosaurus that some paleontologists would put well over 100 feet long. So these are huge, huge creatures. Here's a picture of what a Diplodocus would look like when you size it up against a human or an elephant. Some of these creatures, as I mentioned, were about 100 feet long, had huge tails and huge necks. And some people who have looked at the physics of this animal would say, well, you really can't have a long neck without a long tail, and you can't have a long tail without a long neck. It's like there's a suspension bridge construction going on here, where the two things really work in cooperation with each other. But this was a humongous creature. Now let's take a quicker, closely look at the vertebrae of this creature, and specifically I want to take a look at these things called chevron bones. If we zoom into the neck, you can see that these linking bones down here, you can also see them on this skeleton here, this neck system that hangs down here, they're called chevron bones, and they're a perfect area for tendons and ligaments to link and connect with the muscles and the connective tissue so that this animal could live and breathe and swallow and do all of these things without basically choking itself. I mean, without these chevron bones and the linking system that could work between them with the ligaments, the muscles, the tendons and everything, it would basically look down to the ground and fold its neck in half. You can't have a creature like this live without some really smart design work going in to not only linking and connecting vertebrae, but linking and connecting chevron bones that, you know, do things like preventing the neck from pinching the veins. They surround the esophagus and the trachea. We're looking at a really well-designed creature here that was tens of thousands of pounds, and we would see it specifically as divine engineering. Now let's go on and next and just take another quick look at another type of dinosaur. This is a Triceratops. The two top horns in some cases could exceed 4 feet long. They have one of the largest skulls of all dinosaurs, including the frill. Some of them have been found over 8 feet long. Some people speculate just the head on this creature could weigh up to 4,000 pounds and probably run about the same speed as a rhinoceros, given the body plan that this creature has. But it's a really amazing design when you look at this. I was at a museum with Margaret Helder. She's a creation scientist up in Canada. She took me around the Royal Tyrrell Museum and says, I want you to take a look at the underside of this dinosaur's head. And she pointed out this thing called the occipital condyle, which is right here. This is what's on the base of the skull of a Triceratops, and it makes for a ball and joint system that really resembles like a trailer ball and a trailer hitch system, so that this gigantic head could mount down on the tip, on the ending part of the spine, so that its head could revolve and turn and look around. Without this type of incredible system, you really couldn't have a Triceratops look around, twist, bend its head, and rotate it in several different directions like you're observing here on the screen. We view this as masterful planning and really divine engineering. And of course, if you put a head on a skull any other way besides the way I just showed you, you couldn't have two Triceratops run at each other like this without their heads falling off. So we have some amazing design markers in these dinosaurs. When we really step back and look at them, we have to admit, secular or creation, there's an amazing body plan going into these creatures. So the next line of evidence I want to take a look at is the lack of transitions and the lack of ancestors. This is actually an image that was from a dinosaur encyclopedia book. It's completely secular. And I found it real interesting in this book that they have all of the yellow lines of data represent actual real fossil evidence for these different types or different kinds of dinosaurs growing across the top here. But all of the gray lines, the connecting branches that are between the actual fossil evidence, are imagined theoretical connections. And it goes all the way down here to the imagined ancestor. And notice that the book even admits, if it's in gray, it's a theory, it's an imagination, it's speculation of what we believe happened with these creatures. So when you take away the gray, all you're left with is actual fossil evidence of these creatures. And if you were to take away the idea of radiometric dating and deep time, which has a lot of assumptions behind it, it's almost like you just have several different individual kinds of dinosaurs that were created on the sixth day of creation, each after their kind, just like the Bible says. I find it really fascinating that this secular book would even admit that we have the actual data in the yellow here. So we have these kinds of creatures, but we don't know the transitions and we don't know the ancestors. And without the ancestors and without the transitions, you really can't have a ironclad case for evolution theory. This phenomenon actually continues when you go to museums. You'll see the same thing, just positioned in a slightly different way. This is a picture of the same dinosaur tree that was at a secular museum. You can see here that they admit that there's about 78 different T-Rexes that have been found and 287 sauropod dinosaurs and 242 armored plant eaters, and the ceratopsians are over here. But this museum admits that when it comes to the transitions between these types of dinosaurs and when it comes to the ancestors, they're all zeros and they're all question marks. And that's because they really don't have any clear transitions that go between these different kinds of dinosaurs. This data better fits the biblical explanation that these creatures were divinely and spontaneously created by God and put down on this planet on the sixth day of creation. This even continues when you look at some quotes here that we have from secular paleontologists. This is from a doctor who has written several different books about dinosaurs, and he says, "From my reading of the fossil record of dinosaurs, no direct ancestors have been discovered for any dinosaur species." That's a very strong statement for a paleontologist to admit, to say that there's no direct ancestors, and at last, my list of dinosaurian ancestors is an empty one. When you look at things like pterodactyls or pterosaurs specifically, here's a citation from a person who's done a lot of study on pterosaurs and says, "We know only little about the evolution of pterosaurs. The ancestors are not known. When these pterosaurs first appear in the geologic record, they were perfect pterosaurs, completely perfect. They just show up in the fossil record. There's no animal evidence, there's no transitions of creatures moving from one type to another type and then finally over to pterosaurs. When they dig up pterosaurs in the soil, they're always showing up as fully formed functional pterosaurs." And again, that site is from a secular site. So next we'll look at the fact that these dinosaurs were created for a pre-flood world. This is just a really quick tour, but there are secular books that spend a lot of time on this, saying that these dinosaur creatures are really built better suited for a different type of Earth atmosphere. We would certainly agree with that. When you look at a giant Apatosaurus dinosaur here, they've learned that the nasal passages of these creatures, even though it's 100 feet long and can weigh over 80,000 pounds, the nasal passages are only twice the size of a modern day horse. That presents a very interesting problem. How do you get enough oxygen into this creature through these two little tiny nasal passages that are twice the size of a horse to feed the blood and tissue necessary for, you know, an 80,000 pound dinosaur? So clearly when this dinosaur lived in the pre-flood world, there had to be different pressures, different oxygen levels, and so forth. The same phenomenons are observed with pterodactyls. The biggest one that they've discovered so far has got about a 53-foot wingspan, and they've looked at the flight physics required for these creatures to fly and have determined you'd have to even hit it with 16-mile-an-hour winds just to get its toes up off of the ground, because it's not built for flying in today's Earth atmosphere. Same thing goes on with these huge dragonflies. The fossil record bears out that there are dragonflies with 2.5-foot wingspans, obviously could not fly around very well in today's Earth climate. That's why we believe that these creatures are pre-flood creatures. Next, let's look at the extent of the dinosaur graveyards. This is the Morrison Foundation, 700,000 square miles covering, I believe it's 13 different states, where we have over 100 dinosaur quarries. So something happened catastrophic global to bury animals into the realm of tens of thousands across all these different states in the 700,000 square mile geologic formation called the Morrison Foundation that has more dinosaurs than anywhere else in the North American continent. Here we have a printout from the Fossil Works database showing that the ground is filled with fossils all over the place. There are, of course, billions and billions of fossils. We believe that these fossils and these barriers all over the place, most of them were created by Noah's flood. It's really a testament and some strong proof to the flood that actually happened. We did some research by going around to these different museums, either online or in person, trying to find out what they would admit was the cause of death for these animals that died, the dinosaurs specifically, around these different areas in the United States and going on up to Canada. And surprisingly, every single one we were able to vet out admitted that these creatures died from a watery catastrophe. When you go back and you read the fine print, these museums are admitting the dinosaurs died from flood catastrophes. So they come through and admit it. And when you look at the extent of these fossils all over America and Canada, just looking at our area of the world here, and they admit it was a watery catastrophe. Here's just a quick slide showing where most dinosaur finds are found in that Morrison Foundation in the middle of America there. When these dinosaurs are found, for example, this huge hill of fossils that is in Utah, they're typically found scrambled and jumbled up together. Only 3% of the dinosaur fossil record contains what we call articulated dinosaurs. The rest of the fossil record, 97% of it, are scrambled, mangled, mutilated bones that are rolled up in mud and buried catastrophically. Very interesting evidence that would prove Noah's flood really happened. The next one is when you look at how rapidly these creatures were buried. For example, we can go through and look at all these pictures that we've taken at different museums around the US and Canada. You'll notice that these dinosaurs, these are some velociraptors and some T-Rex examples, that are dying in what we call the dinosaur death pose. Their necks are arched back because they're choking on mud during the death process. So they're asphyxiating, they're choking, they're suffocating, gasping for air, and their necks are being arched and pulled back during the death process. This one even shows this happening to a massive T-Rex, where he's choking on mud, pulling his neck back. They've done studies about this using chickens, actually, to show this is exactly what that type of creature would do during the process of choking and dying in mud. Next, I want to show a couple slides here of some trips that we've taken over to the Hilda Bone Bed in Canada, showing that these creatures died while fleeing in herds, huge herds. There's a place in Canada where you can go up in the Hilda Bone Beds where it's over a 1.5 mile square area. So you could walk for about 30 minutes in each direction and you can see dead ceratopsian dinosaurs in these badland formations. You can walk through and see these hoodoos and everything. There are tens of thousands of dead buried ceratopsian dinosaurs, interestingly, that are buried with fish, turtles, marsupials, and amphibians. Several different kinds of dinosaurs, different species, many different families. How do you take land-dwelling, air-breathing dinosaurs and bury them with fish, turtles, marsupials, and amphibians? Well, the one way we can think of that really fits the explanation best would be to say a catastrophic worldwide flood. There's another example here of a bone bed in China. It's several hundred meters long. They actually found 50 different kinds of dinosaurs in this huge mound foundation where all these dinosaur creatures are jumbled up and mixed together and disarticulated and pushed up against a hillside during something that had to be as global and catastrophic as Noah's flood. So the other thing that's interesting, I mentioned a little bit about this, is that dinosaurs are typically found mixed together with marine fossils. A lot of times they're found with shark teeth. it's real interesting when you just step back and look at this. My gosh, how do you take land creatures and marine life and bury them together? Well, you have to take the marine life, lift it up, and move it over on land, drown the animals, and that's the most logical explanation of why you would have them all buried together. And Noah's flood would certainly fit a catalyst for that. Dr. Jack Horner is one of the leading secular paleontologists. He did an interesting study here where he found that this certain type of dinosaur, in just one location, they went and found 10,000 adults, but zero young. So what type of event would cause about 10,000 of these creatures to run, flee for their lives, be buried in mud, and leave all the juveniles behind? We certainly think that this would support, yet again, Noah's flood is the best possible explanation for why you can find 10,000 of one kind of dinosaurs buried together with zero young around, because they're ditching the youngsters as they're trying to evade something that they see coming. Next, I want to take just a very quick, brief look at dinosaurs or dragons in history. I'm certainly not going to hold our claim up on trying to prove that dinosaurs were created on the sixth day of creation just 6,000 years ago based upon this, but this is actually an interesting journey of study. When you look across the globe, you'll find that most people groups, not everyone, but most people groups have myths, legends, drawings, historical accounts, even ancient mystery, military accounts of dragon and dinosaur-like creatures. And many of these groups probably did not communicate well, but they have similar overlapping, sometimes parallel stories or cave drawings of similar types of creatures that looked like dragons, that when you take back that word and think, well, they're drawn dragons, but they're really different types of dinosaurs. I find it most interestingly when you talk about this that here are just an example of five different historians and world travelers that we rely on for building history all the way back from, you know, we've got the 13th century, 1st century, 2nd century, all the way back to the time of Christ. These are world-renowned historians, Marco Polo, Pliny the Elder. You can open up many college-level history books today and see how much we depend on these individuals for assembling our history and what we understand about the past. Well, why is it then that when all five of these individuals talk about seeing, measuring in some cases, and really vividly describing massive dragon-like creatures living alongside with man, why do we discard just that part of their testimony? It seems like we're willing to listen to their testimony and their history about all kinds of world events, but when it comes to when these people speak about dragons and dinosaurs living alongside with man, their stories are quickly disregarded as fiction. I just thought that was interesting to point it out. Vance Nelson has published a great book called Untold Secrets of Planet Earth, Dire Dragons, and where he goes over several different historical accounts of dinosaurs living alongside with man, because we believe that after Noah's flood, there were very scant, rare dinosaurs that still lived for hundreds of years. Are they around today? Probably not. But we do believe that they lived for hundreds of years after the flood and quickly went extinct as they were hunted down by man and really didn't have a lot of food supply like they had in the first version of the world. Okay, with that, I'm going to hand it over to my colleague Brian to take us through the 14 fresh biomaterials here.
Hey, real quick, as we're moving over to that, and I know, Brian, you got a ton of great information that I can't wait for you to share with us. There was a question that came in, and Reed asked it a couple times. Why do we not find dinosaur bones and human bones buried together? Brian, is there a good answer on that one? You seem to write about this a lot.
Well, I think there's a good answer, and it starts with looking at the dinosaur fossils and the animals that do occur with them, and they're all swamp animals and plants. So we don't see people with dinosaur fossils, but we don't see lions, tigers, bears, or dogs and cats either. I think the hard ground dwelling, the central continent living animals and man lived together, and they probably were inundated at a different time. And so the dinosaur rocks, you know, they don't record all the animals that lived at that time in the pre-flood world. They just record the animals that lived, you know, in the swamps and mixed with sea creatures and lake creatures and things like that. So that's one reason.
Okay, interesting. I actually saw David Harrison replied. He said, hey, you don't find the coelacanth fossil buried with humans, but they're coexisting today at the same time. So just because we don't find the bones buried together too, doesn't mean that those animals are, you know, didn't live together. Animals and people did not live together. Now, you would hold to a literal young earth or a literal biblical creation, we call it a 6,000-year-old earth. Is that correct?
Yeah, I believe the Bible and exactly what it says, and I think that that science backs that up. I didn't always believe that. I was an evolutionist for many years. I believed I evolved from an ape, and the whole ball of wax. And then I was challenged about how they date fossil layers, and when I investigated the methods they use, I realized that it's not all that it was that I was told, and so that opened up a whole big investigation. And 5 years later, I ended up on the other end of that investigation, realizing, you know, the Bible was actually right all along. And that's why I'm passionate about doing what I do.
That is amazing. Well, there's probably some people that are going to be watching this right here that are going to be watching the information you're about to share on these 14 different pieces of or different kinds of biomaterial that have been discovered. And you know, I hope that this launches them on a journey of saying, okay, let me be real honest. What does this mean? Right before you jump into that, I know you're going to do that. Dan, real quick, I had somebody on the chat asking, hey, what's up with when did it change from dragons to dinosaurs? What happened there? When did that transition take place? Can you give that a 10-second answer?
Absolutely. Sir Richard Owen termed dinosauria, the term dinosaurs, in about 1841. So you go back and look at the King James Bible, they would refer to them as dragons, but it was Sir Richard Owen in 1841 who originally coined the term dinosaurs.
Well, there you go. And I know many of you have questions that you're asking that I haven't exactly had a chance to get to. We hopefully will get to a couple more of those at the end. Wanted to let you know about a great search engine, though, called searchcreation.org. We'll throw it up in the chat for you. Searchcreation.org indexes the top 25 websites on creation, evolution, science, the Bible, apologetics. So if you have any question like, why don't we find dinosaur bones and human bones together? That's a great place to ask that question, and you'll get nothing but great responses from that search engine at searchcreation.org. All right, Brian, we know we're going to go a little over time here. That's okay. You've got some amazing material. As I went through the slides, it blew my mind. Start sharing with us some of the information that you put together here.
Yeah, sure. I want to share a little bit about what we found, what secular scientists have found in the fossils that has really, it's the number one sort of a renaissance in paleontology. And then at the end, I want to just share, you know, what it means. So what they found and then what it means. So let me tab over to the slide and see if I can, I'm going to share this and.
There we go. Yeah, you're so on.
Can everyone see it?
You are on. Yep.
Yes, sir.
All right. So Dr. Biddle ended with this slide, and it shows the cover of a Creation Research Society quarterly that the whole issue of this technical journal was dedicated to reinterpreting, I guess, all the soft tissue and molecular preservation finds, and it also refutes the iron preservation model that was published just 2 years ago and was in the movie Jurassic World. So that's a handy resource. You can order back issues from CRSQ. But here's what we found, and we got the biomaterial number one, and we're going to run through 14 of these. Actually, why don't you do this, you guys that are chatting over there. See if you can list from the top of your head specific biomaterials, like specific names of proteins. Can you name any that scientists have discovered in fossils? And maybe you can start naming those. And and I'm going to go through. The first one is blood vessels. And you wouldn't think that blood vessels would last for millions of years. And that's rightly so. They shouldn't last for millions of years because blood vessels are made of flattened skin cells, epithelial cells. And those are mostly, they're like skin cells. And they're made mostly of collagen protein. And scientists have measured the decay rate of collagen protein and found that it doesn't last any longer than about 900,000 years. And that's if it's kept really cold. So you can find references to the decay rates in our on our website, icr.org, and in our newest books that I'll show you here and give you a coupon for here at the end. Another material that made it into the scientific literature, here's from the journal Science in 2005. You can see blood cell, well, what some call a blood cell-like element, but it's circular, it's red, and it has hemoglobin in it. It looks like a blood cell, you know, an erythrocyte. So that's in a dinosaur, not just T-Rex, but also Hadrosaur, published in 2009 to verify that we are looking at blood cells and they're just the right size and shape to and color to identify as blood cells. Now, this is after the bone has been demineralized in acid. So they take the hard part away and all that's left is the proteins and the cells, if there is any. And it turns out there is some left in some of these bones, some of these fossil bones. A third biomaterial is hemoglobin. And so if you look inside of a red blood cell, that's what you would find is many thousands of these proteins. I remember reading a paper that was about the evolution of a mosasaur, and the authors of the paper published in PLOS One in 2011 said, there's also a little red patch in the chest cavity, and we think it may be the remains. In fact, we tested it and discovered that it's got hemoglobin in it, remains of the of where the heart was in this mosasaur. And then I went a couple of years later and had a chance to see it myself, and I got pictures of hemoglobin still coloring this patch red in a mosasaur in LA County Museum of Natural History. Now, number four, fresh bone cells. So these are osteocytes. And here's an image of a Triceratops horn with a tape measure being excavated from Hell Creek Formation in Montana. And they demineralized the horn and published these images in 2013. And on the bottom right, where it says 10 microns, you see these two blob-looking shapes with little extensions coming off. Those are filopodia from osteocytes. So the osteocytes are still there. Blood vessel walls are still preserved. You can see on images 14 and 15. So this should be all gone. None of the there's no scientific reason based on the decay rates of proteins and biomaterials like cells and lipids and things that make up cells. There's no reason to think that these could last any longer than say something on the order of tens or maybe possibly hundreds of thousands of years, but not certainly not 1 million, let alone you know, tens of millions. So there's a real science dilemma here. And so that's what we're proposing is one way to solve this dilemma as we look at ovalbumin. Is to suggest that the timing is off. So it's not millions of years old after all. That would explain why we have all these fresh biomaterials. Number five, ovalbumin is found in egg yolk and egg shell. And but it doesn't last long. There's no reason to suggest it could last any longer than what protein decay studies point to. And that's thousands, not millions. And so what's it doing in a in an Argentina dinosaur fossil eggshell? And there it was. They found it in the dinosaur eggshell. So these are like timers. They're like egg timers. You know, you take your egg timer and you twist it all the way, and then 60 minutes later, the thing goes ding and it stops ticking. But what we're looking at here is the fifth separate egg timer, and it's still ticking. And we have another one, chitin, and we see chitin in lots of these amber fossils. The age assignments on some of these ambers are real high, you know, 100 million years, something like that, for many of them. But again, there's no evidence that chitin can last even 1 million years. It's associated with a protein that holds it together, so it's integrally linked with chitin-associated protein. So whenever you see chitin, if it's still intact, it's got protein with it. And in any case, researchers have found it in the Paleozoic. So they found it in, you know, the age assignments for those discoveries are something on the order of 300 million years. And it has original chitin in it. And I'm saying, give me a break. Unless there's some kind of magic going on to preserve something for more than a million years, then really we should throw the science away. This the decay rate study. Now there's no decay rate specifically for chitin that I know of, but there are decay rates for certain of these biomaterials. And by extension, we know what's happening with the chemistry. We understand the chemical process of breaking these down. You know, they spontaneously break down over time. And if you add a little bit of heat, it accelerates the breakdown process. And that's why
I'm going to stop right there, because I'm getting a lot of people in the chat saying, well, I thought they did prove that, you know, there should be soft tissue. That stuff should happen. We should expect that to happen. But in reality, this whole thing that you're going through is part of that iDino research that was done. And I think we'll throw that, somebody try to find that, and we'll throw that link in the chat. But you're saying all these things, all these biomaterials you're going through, and you're saying there's no way that this stuff should be able to last for that long.
Well, it's not me saying it. It's evolutionists saying it.
Wow.
Okay, so I'm just taking their words, and I'm reporting to you what they have told the scientific literature. They have said, hey, these decay rates show and demonstrate repeatedly that hemoglobin only lasts thousands of years. And I have the reference. You can look it up on ICR.org or, you know, any number of these creation websites. It's not hidden. And they're the ones that have come and said, here's the collagen decay rate. They're the ones that have said, we've measured the decay rate of DNA, and here it is, DNA in fossils. And so then they're also the ones who come and said, look, we found collagen in these fossils that are millions of years old. They're the ones who said, we found DNA in fossils that are millions of years old. They're the ones who said, look, we've discovered and confirmed hemoglobin and all these different timers in fossils that are supposed to be millions of years old. So there's a huge conflict that they present. And I'm just letting you know that they're presenting these, they're discovering these things. And one good, solid, scientific way to answer their questions is to question their time frame. So if you remove the millions of years, then the decay rate science stands firm, makes sense, and the discoveries stand firm and make sense. But you're right, Eric, I'm just putting out these timers that they've published in the literature. But if chitin should last millions of years, then you'd think it would fill forests with dead ants, you know, and fill sea floors with dead krill. But chitin doesn't last that long. Nor does unmineralized bone. So let me show you one of my bones that I have here. Yeah, real quick. So I've got this dinosaur bone. It's one of my favorite bones in my office, and you can see that it's still colored white, and it's just right out of the ground. It's still dirty. I haven't even cleaned it, and you can see on the inside of this, this is the epiphysis of a hadrosaur tibia. You can see the different little holes and gaps where there's trabecular bone there. And so this is our next, you wouldn't expect to see this. I mean, bones do fall apart, and these should turn into dust. So this shouldn't exist at all, unless it was like turned into mineral And a lot of times bones are turned into mineral, but sometimes they're not. They're not mineralized at all. And that's what we're saying is another biomaterial.
So hang on, Brian. The bone that you just held up is a dinosaur bone.
Yes.
It is not mineralized, petrified. I mean, it's actual bone.
Right.
Which, if it's 65 million years old, it should not be real bone like that anymore.
Right. I mean, they're turning into dust. When you excavate these things, sometimes they just fall apart. But in other cases, they're just the original bone. It's like getting an old cow bone out of a field, except you're getting it out of the ground. We shouldn't expect that. If it's millions of years old, it doesn't look that like that at all. And so here's the clincher to me when I saw this collagen, because they have decay rate studies over and over for collagen, bone collagen. And yet here's an image of actual dinosaur claw. This is from a dinosaur claw from Canada. And the claw was in a museum, in a British museum for 100 years. And these scientists from England, they pulled it out, they broke it open, and they used a new technique, electron microscopy, to image these fibrils. So you're looking at microscopic fibrils made of protein, and they verified again a collagen protein. Several studies have verified collagen protein in a lot of different ways, even sequenced it from T-Rex and from Hadrosaur collagen protein sequence. Bacteria don't make collagen, and collagen does not last longer than about a million years, not even really that long, at reasonable Earth surface temperatures. But what about DNA? I mean, if we found DNA, that even has a shorter half-life. So if collagen has an egg timer of like 60 minutes, DNA would have an egg timer of maybe 1 minute, 1/60th or so. It doesn't last as long as collagen should. And yet there's a couple studies that have shown or have discovered signatures of DNA in fossils that are designated millions of years. I don't buy it. I don't think the millions of years is true. If it was, we wouldn't see things like DNA or skin pigments. You can see in this, this is the author, Tiergarten, of a couple of studies. One just came out a few months ago, and I got the image from it. This is a Psittacosaurus from China. It's a spectacular fossil, but you can see the UV lamp reflects brightly when it bounces off of rock matrix, but when it hits flesh, like skin and bone, the UV light doesn't reflect the same way it reflects back with a dull image. So you can see that you're not looking at mineral at all. This is actual skin. It's just like a natural mummy. And so he was able to figure out that it was shaded darkly on its belly because it still has melanin and pigment in it. Melanin's in all kinds of fossils. One just came out today. Dr. Biddle sent me a link to a bird fossil paper that just came out today showing original melanin and keratin protein. We also have number 11, PHEX. And this is another protein that vertebrates have and bacteria do not. So a lot of people say, hey, maybe that's bacteria that you find in these fossils. Well, bacteria don't make any of the things that we're looking at. They don't make histone because they don't have to pack their DNA into such tight spaces. They have less DNA than a lot of vertebrates. So, but histone is shown in this image as a, you can see the strings are wrapped around the outside. That's DNA. Histone is like a spool, and the DNA is like a thread wrapped around the spool. So anyway, this histone protein, they found this in dinosaur nuclei in bone cells, osteocytes. That's amazing. And there's no reason to think, let me just put it this way, there's every reason to think that proteins like this should have fallen apart within just thousands of years, based on what we know about the second law of thermodynamics and how things fall apart unless they're put back together through an outside agent. Okay, we're getting down to it. And the last one we're looking at, the second to last one, is keratin, another protein. This is in your fingernails and hair and also lizard scales. And so they found original keratin protein in this lizard scale. And then the last one is a protein called elastin. Again, bacteria don't make these, so bacteria can't explain it. But this is an amazing list. I mean, we have 14, and there's more than 14, but we just selected 14, or Dr. Biddle did, just to illustrate. We have 14 timers that are still ticking, and not one of them is expected based on decay rate studies to last, even a million years. And so, of course, we're going somewhere with this, aren't we? We're saying that if these things suggest, let me just run through this slide here. Lab contamination can't explain all this. Bacteria can't explain all this. So there must be some motivation other than honest science that puts forth these wild speculations against the evidence. Here is the evidence. It shows each line shows a million years, and the flood is just 1/233 of one line, and collagen max life is way up there also. And so you've got these million years designated for all these proteins are supposed to be millions of years old. It just doesn't match, you see. So the max life for these proteins would be way up at the inside the top line, and yet the age assignment is at the bottom line or below it. And so there's this huge, 65 times mismatch. But if you remove the millions of years, the mismatch is gone, the problem is solved. And all these timers actually independently confirm the thousands, not millions, interpretation of the fossils and the rock layers that they represent. And finally, there's a bonus confirmation, and that is radiocarbon. We do keep finding small amounts of radiocarbon in fossils. And so that's like another timer, totally independent of proteins, that also indicates thousands, not millions. So that's what's going on, but that's the what we found. And so I want to talk about what difference does it make. And so the difference that it makes to me is that we have 14 separate eyewitnesses from the fossils, if you will, that confirm the actual eyewitnesses that wrote Genesis. And so I think that we have science that confirms the Bible in these fossils. And it's an amazing time to be studying fossils these days because of these brand new discoveries. And more come out every month, just like the one that came out today. And listen, if the Bible's right about history, this is the bottom line for me. If the Bible got it right about creation, about the flood, then the Bible's right about it, about everything. And so when it tells me, hey, you're a sinner, you need salvation, then I got to say, God actually created the world. He created me. I owe him my life. And everything that the Bible says is actually written by him. And if science backs it up, then I need to stop bringing up excuses. And I need to reckon and get to know this creator who's trying desperately to get to know me. And to me, that's where this evidence points.
Well, Brian, I could not agree with you more. I think it just continues to show we heap evidence upon evidence upon evidence that what they have taught for over 100 years now, that dinosaurs are probably very old and they died 65 million years ago. Dan, the information you shared, they've always lived with man, used to be called dragons. And now this, all of these different types of fresh biomaterial, as you called it, Dan, indicate that, look, all these little timers show these things are not 65 million years old. Now, I realize some of you, Reed, I see you in the comments. I see you saying, hang on, I don't think those were real blood vessels, or this report says those weren't real blood vessels. There's actually a lot more information you can get on this. And Brian, you actually, You guys put together a DVD series on this topic specifically, didn't you?
Yeah, and you guys in the webinar are going to get the big old coupon for this, but it's is that reversed? Anyway, it's called Uncovering the Truth About Dinosaurs, and it's 4 episodes, and they're TV quality. So this is the kind of DVD that you'd be proud to show to any mix, to any group.
I did.
It's not just a talking head. It's actually on location, and it's really well produced. So yeah,
I did it. I went ahead and threw that up in the chat so that you guys could see that offer. Now, when you click on that, it'll open up in a new tab, but Brian's got something even better for you, because Brian, you're going to give them a 20% discount on that series and anything else they get from the ICR store. Is that right?
Yeah, so you webinar guys, you get 20% off. And all you have to do is go to store.icr.org and type in BRIAN, the number 4, and the letter U. So that'd be Brian for you. And you get 20% off of Uncovering the Truth About Dinosaurs, or my book, Dinosaurs in the Bible, or our new book, The Guide to Dinosaurs. So, or any other product. So 20% off. Is a good deal.
That is a really good deal. Thank you for making that available to everybody. I know with Christmas coming up, what a great time to say, hey, I'm going to look at all the different stuff you guys got on dinosaurs. I'm going to grab something. I'm going to wrap it up for a present and give that away. So take advantage of that 20% off. I put it in the chat, but it's Brian, BRIAN, the number 4, then the letter U. Brian for you, because Brian is for you learning this information. So he's going to give you 20% off anything in the ICR store. But if I were you, I'd take advantage of that Uncovering the Truth About Dinosaurs DVD series that answers so many more questions than we could even have time to answer here. Okay, so Brian, real quick, what would you say about the people that say, how many different, can I call them excuses? How many different excuses have you heard for dismissing all these different evidences that you just showed on fresh biomaterial?
To me, are you asking me how many, are you asking me to give you a number?
Well, if you know a number, I mean, I know they say iron was discovered and that's what preserved this soft tissue. And, they say these different things, and what I see coming out is them desperately trying to preserve the idea that dinosaurs are 65 million years old. They're not questioning the age of the dinosaurs, which I think they should be. Instead, they're questioning, well, how can we make this last for 65 million years? What can account for this, all this information you gave us?
That's right. And that's the question they're asking. They're asking, how did this last 65 million years old? And at that point, they're engaging in circular reasoning. They're assuming that it's 65 million years old, and then they're asking the question to try to find out how it did last 65 million years old. And that's not scientific. And I'm saying, let's do better science and let's question all the presumptions that are going into this.
Yeah, you really have two options, Brian. You're absolutely right. You can either make the dinosaurs younger or the original organics have to be older. And it's torn between those two tensions there. And of course, they're not going to make dinosaurs younger, but that would be the more natural explanation to the phenomenon we're seeing.
Okay, guys, so Bill is in the chat, and Bill says, you guys, the presenters, ignored scientific explanations for the preserved biomaterial. You haven't even talked about the scientific explanations for this. And I look back at what you were just saying and teaching through the slide deck and what Dan has put together and what you put together, and I go, you have used the evolutionary scientific research to say these are the timers, like you said, like an egg timer. Each one of these biomaterials is a timer that can only last so long. And the oldest one, the one that lasts the longest, is still many, 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 many times over younger than the supposedly 65 million year old age of dinosaurs.
Well, of course, anyone can claim that we ignore this or that, because we can't get to everything in one short webinar. So why fault us for not being comprehensive when that's not at all our intent? There are resources out there that are comprehensive. And the preservation scenarios that evolutionists have concocted have been, some of them are really silly. Some of them are interesting and helpful to a degree, but some of them are bad science. And I'm not saying that because I'm determined to believe, you know, in a thousands of years old world a priori. I'm saying that because it's bad science. For example, the Fenton chemistry that they talk about with the iron preservation model, the Fenton chemistry reactions, they do 100 times more destructive reactions, chemical reactions. So they should tear apart these molecules 100 times more probably than they would cross-link them to supposedly preserve them. So it's a story. It's a story that these authors told, and it's been refuted in the iDino issue. It's refuted on our website, icr.org, in different places, and in our materials too.
Fantastic. Rob is asking Bill Nye, is that you? So Bill Nye, if that is you, and you said right here you'd love to debate on this. You're a member of the NCSE, GSA, and SW Paleo Society. I really do hope that this at least puts a rock in your shoe and makes you go, hang on. How do we account for all this soft or fresh, so to speak, biomaterial that shouldn't be there? The very bone that he's holding that is still bone rather than petrified or mineralized or anything else. So fascinating stuff. So at some point, how many debates are out there on this, on the subject? Either you or Dan know of a debate out there specifically on the biomaterial that's been discovered?
Go ahead, Brian. I was just going to say that it's such an issue that was even in the Jurassic Park movie, the latest one that came out, they tried to have an explanation for the iron preservation put right in the movie script. So I thought that was quite interesting.
Yeah, I don't know. But there's debates and, you know, probably online debates and things. But I don't have time for. I'm too busy researching.
Well, and you know, that's what I was going to say. First of all, Bill, thank you for joining us on this webinar. I really appreciate you kind of taking time to listen to the other side. I feel like I regularly listen to what atheists have to say and what evolutionists have to say, because I really want to know what they're trying to communicate. So thank you for coming and listening to what the other side has to say. Really respect you for taking time to do that. And there really are some well-researched published journals that actually have this documented information in it that I think it'd be really good for you to look up. Dan gave out his email address, and he said he'd email you some of the articles and some of the journals on that. Dan, you're good with doing that, right?
Please do. Yeah, I put my email in the chat box there. I'll throw it up again. If anyone has questions, we'd be glad to help.
Hey, speaking of help, I know how much you want to help other people, and you are actually willing, if people want it, to give away your book and your DVD, Debunking Evolution, which goes through a bunch of different stuff other than dinosaur soft tissue that's been discovered. And you're literally going to give that away to everybody. Is that right? You're going to ship them a DVD you're going to ship them a book. Is that how this works?
Absolutely. It's really designed for students. We have a student guide and a DVD that we're wanting to ship out for free to anyone who just goes to our webpage right now. We've left the part at the very top of our webpage. If you go to debunkevolution.com, see in the very top of the page there will be a form that you can fill out, and we'd be glad to ship you a free DVD and book.
I've got the link right there for you. It should have taken over your chat for a second. And you can either close it or take the offer. Simply put in your information, and he literally will ship out that DVD and ship out that book to you. So, man, Dan, thank you for making that available to so many people. Really appreciate that.
Certainly. And, Eric, have you given instructions for people for downloading our PowerPoint as well?
I have not. That's next. I wanted to end and thank you guys for being on here and for going through all this material with us. Really, really appreciate it. What you guys have compiled really is fascinating. Do you have any final words? And then I'm going to give away the PowerPoint.
I think I'm good. Thank you for having us. This has been a lot of fun, and I trust that Brian and I can do more things like this together in the future. It's been a great time.
It's just great to be able to connect from three different states across the country, and then to connect with folks from different countries even. Not just to connect for the sake of connecting, but to connect for the sake of showing that this, that there is real legitimate science that does confirm the Bible. I think it's great. So I appreciate you guys putting this together.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Point. Awesome. Well, here's what I'm going to do, guys. I'm going to hit this, load this offer up. It's going to come up on your screen and it's actually a link. And I'm actually going to have Clint grab that link and put it in the chat as well. But all you got to do, if you want the PowerPoint that they went through so you can dissect it, what they didn't even show you at the very end of the PowerPoint, the last slide, couple slides, are all the footnotes. So everything is footnoted for you to be able to go. Bill, you can look right there at the footnotes, going to the evolutionary journals, going to those science journals and saying, hey, we got a problem here. And that link is going to be available. You'll see a timer there. That offer is going to expire. That link is available for the next 24 hours. So if you want to take advantage of downloading that PowerPoint, it is a 43 megabyte file. You need to click that link and get that downloaded in the next 24 hours. So if you do that, I'm sure you're going to really enjoy that and enjoy going and looking through. Dan left some notes in the notes section of each PowerPoint slide so you can really kind of walk back through some of this information they presented. And guys, I'd love to do this again. I think there's more people out there that want to know the truth about dinosaur soft tissue, what it means. And Brian, you hit the nail on the head there. It means, once again, we see the scientific evidence confirming what God's word has already told us. And I use that word confirm on purpose because this really, and I don't have time to go into this, but I put the Bible as my authority. I'd love to go through an entire talk that explains why I do that. We won't do that now. But this evidence comes underneath and confirms what the Bible has already told us. God said he created the world. He said he made it about 6,000 years ago. He said there was a worldwide flood that destroyed the world. We see evidence of dinosaurs in this death pose, what reptiles do when they're in water and when they're choking and they go into that same pose and we see them buried like that. The evidence we see fits. We find 14 different biomaterials that fit the idea that they're only died about 4,400 years ago. And that leads to the conclusion that, wow, all of the Old Testament, you'll understand as you read it, and all of Genesis points to the man Jesus Christ that was going to come. It's where we start the New Testament. That's why we're in the year 2016 today. We started with zero at the time of Christ. And I know the calendar is a little bit messed up, but we are in the AD period, the year of our Lord. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ, who wasn't just our creator. But when man sinned and messed everything up, he said, I'm going to come. I'm going to restore that relationship and become their savior. And he is the only one that is willing and able to offer forgiveness of sins, your sins and my sins. And anybody who's willing to repent and trust in what Christ did through his death, burial, and resurrection on the cross can be saved. So if you want more information on that, I've got a great article called How to Be Saved. And you can find that at creationtoday.org. Just look up How to Be Saved on our search engine. And I'd love for you to read that article. It goes into a lot more information there. Dan and Brian, thank you guys for joining me. Everybody on the chat, really appreciate you being here. As you leave, before you leave the chat, put one more thing in there. Tell me where you're from. I didn't get to do that at the beginning. Tell me where you're from. And I've got a bunch of creation ministry people out there that do all kinds of great ministry. If you guys would, in the chat right now, throw up what ministry you're with when you throw up your location. So put your ministry address or email address or website address in there and tell me where you're from. And tell me if you do creation ministry, throw your website up there so people can see all the different creation ministries that get to take place around the United States. I absolutely love it. Well, guys, we'll stay on the chat for a little while, but the video is going to end here. Dan, Brian, thank you so much for joining me. And for everybody watching, thank you so much for joining. I hope it was a real blessing to you.
You're welcome. Thanks, Eric.
God bless.